We now move into our next session. This is on building a brand in the education space, leveraging your brand to accelerate growth and enterprise value. Speaking to us on this topic is a founding member of Brand Capital. Since its inception in 2005, he helped Times Group set up and grow Brand Capital with the help of significant private equity investments across sectors and across regions. He has a track record of building and mentoring teams and organizations that succeed and outperform. He has more than 17 years of experience in investment banking, fund management, consulting, brand development and management, international trade, marketing and sales, having worked with corporates in some of the top consulting firms in India and abroad. Please join me now in welcoming the Associate Vice President, Brand Capital, Mr. Diwakar Dadu. Gentlemen, all of you are having conversations here in front. Could you please take it outside so our next speaker can have the undivided attention of the audience here, please. Thank you.
That I try and keep all of you awake. So let's see if I can do that. I was going through the delegate list and I realized that about more than 80% of the delegates here represent some form of educational business. You see, I'm sure all of us know about what's happening on the education space, so I'm not going to spend too much of time on that. Many of us also know about what's happening on the investment in the education space. And I'm sure we also know what brand building is. This presentation that I'm going to take you through, and I'll try and stick to the time limit so that you can have your tea in time, is basically going to be an attempt to put all three in perspective, which is to building a brand in the education space to help accelerate growth and enterprise value. Some facts, I'm not going to dwell onto the details, but key point, largest student population in the world. We know the market size, I'm not getting into data. Being from a media house, I can also tell you that there are more than 50,000 communicating advertisers in this space as of now, which to some extent is also a reflection of the clutter that we have in the market. Education continues to be the third largest expenditure for an Indian household. And in the morning, Louis Miranda was talking about 2-3 years ago, somebody telling him that education is the third largest advertising category. As per TAMADIC's data, 2010-11, education is the largest advertising category. And followed by real estate. So education is the largest advertising category. Okay, we talked about what the government does, what the regulators do. Some of you might end up calling me a diehard optimist, but that's the way I am. And let's try and look at things as a glass half full rather than a glass half empty. So with all the allocations, with all the aggressions in terms of targets and all of that, Mr. Kapil Sibal has also gone to record to say that the government is receptive today as compared to what it was in the past to look at PPP. He's gone to the extent of saying, let's use the government infrastructure and let's get the dynamism from the private sector. What he's looking forward to is dynamism. What he's looking forward to is operations, operation management. And he's also talked about building, creating education brands. So, net-net, where are we? What's the scenario that's emerging in the sector? KG to PG, you have huge players, huge number of players, and they're growing by the day. As we talk, I'm sure there'll be a business that's being set up. The PNL model has come into this industry. Let's appreciate it. CEOs have started running this business as a distribution network, quite akin to an FMCG framework. Corporates want to get into this industry, and PE investments are growing. So this is all on the one hand. On the other hand, you have the foreign universities education bill, but you don't expect the Ivy League universities to come in and dilute the brand in India. So you'll at best have probably the second rung foreign universities coming in here. So there will be some borrowing from what Mr. Kapil Sibal has also said, and what I'm going to say now is that India perhaps has that opportunity or that possibility of being marketed as an education destination. But what is important is to be able to market it responsibly. You know, what all we've heard since morning in terms of vision, mission, core values, quality, all of that. Let me also tell you, as an investor, I can also tell you that education, which, at least for myself, I can speak, about 4 years back had considered to be one of the strong sectors, which I call the 8 E's, sectors favorable for investment, still continues to be there. So it's still one of the favored sectors for investment. And why is it so? It's because scalability is possible in this business. Now, we can always sit and argue that scale may not be possible, but if we again look at it and wear a different hat and look at it, scalability is possible because franchising is relatively easier in this business. Infrastructure, which is a hard cost, can be leveraged by collaboration. And technology and IT play a significant role, which is available, which has been developed. So we also say that investments have grown. As an investor, somebody asked in the morning, what is it that will get me the right valuation? Nobody will get you the right valuation. You and your performance and the recognition of your performance is what will get you the right valuation. As investors, we are used to looking at these 8 P's. You see, in India, the premium, India is different from US. In the US, the premium is on concept. In India, the premium is on execution. So, as an investor, what we would tend to look at is, yes, the promoter, his passion for the business, his people, the team that he's created, a differentiated product, a realistic plan. You don't want hockey sticks, so you want a realistic plan. Potential for scaling up, profitable growth, and last but not the least is positioning. That is an intent or an initiative to look at positioning and building the brand at some point in time. So, let's try and spend some time on the last one, that's positioning. Positioning is, however, not so easy. You see, because it is a battle, it's not a battle of products. You might have the best product, but it's definitely a battle and a battle of perceptions. And you have to fight that battle. And it's not easy, especially not when you have a clutter with this kind of presence of establishments, if my data is right. And it's only getting tougher. This is what Tim Westerbeck, who's the managing director of an advertising agency in the United States, who specialize in education ventures, has to say. And this was carried on the front page of New York Times. It's only gotten worse and tougher. Because somebody said, you know, like Shantanu said in the morning, people don't know what to expect. But I think today the students are getting smarter. Their expectations from what is being offered to them are higher. And the list goes on. So what is the solution? The solution to our mind is basically to break away from clutter. And how do you do that? So you have to enter into positioning, into differentiation, which we call as the brand age. So you have to build a brand for yourself. And that's the only way forward. And what is brand? Brand is basically communicating your USP. So you have to start communicating. You might be doing a great job and you expect somebody else to come and recognize you. Doesn't always happen. As human beings, we all have an inert need to communicate. Can any of us sit quietly in one chamber for one day? We cannot. So how do we expect our businesses and companies to sit quiet? They need to communicate. So let's come to, are there any successful Indian education brands? Yes, there are. And what comes to mind are really the legacy brands, you know, the IITs, the IIMs, the Kendriya Vidyalayas. But what about the new age businesses? I have a question for all of you. Can any of you tell me which is the number one Indian education brand on Facebook? Most of us here in this room would be on Facebook. Any other guesses? Any other guesses? Well, you had Asim Chauhan right now, and it is Amity. Amity today is the number one Indian education brand voted on Facebook. And Brand Capital is fortunate to have partnered with them for the last 7 years and been a part of their brand growth story. So what is it that helps build these brands? You have stories of ISB. Now, ISB has come out world, you know, in the new age businesses, has brought in a world-class curriculum, has got great infrastructure, great faculty. But what they also have is a very clear impetus and emphasis on the commercial model. There was a study done by JWT, and it found that the decision to choose an institute, an educational institute, is governed, 60% of that decision is governed by the reputation of that institute. You see, we all in this room will have sons and daughters going to schools. And you can imagine what happens. You want to send your ward to the best possible, the best known institution. And what is this reputation made of? This reputation on one hand, which is nothing but the brand, is made on one hand of the quality, the attributes that help you build that institute. So you have the course, you have the faculty, you have the curriculum, you have the back-end processes somebody spoke about, you have the infrastructure, you have the alumni. So all that is there. But on the other hand is the communication, which is the advertising, which is the promotional material, which is the internets, the blogs and the reviews on the net. And if you put both of them together, then you have what is called recognition, which is in the form of rankings, students' word of mouth, which matters a lot in this space, media coverage, and tie-ups with corporates and so on. So what is the real key to branding education? You see, education is an experiential business. I think somebody else also spoke about it. Education is an experiential business. And therefore, what becomes important is to communicate, identify and communicate your USPs. And you cannot be everything to everybody. So you need to decide which segments you want to be in. If Pathways decided to be in the premium school segment, great. And you have to build trust. So which is basically saying walk the talk. You see, I was in two minds whether to put this slide or not. Everybody is today talking of an impending slowdown. So last three decades, 9 governments in India, on an average, growth rate 6%. More so after the liberalization. Today, GDP, even if it's moved to 7%, and you add another 7% of inflation to it, the question is, are you worse off or better? Perhaps better. But having said that, yes, you do have a euro crisis, you have a rupee depreciating, and therefore the mood is of pessimism. But this is the time. History has proved itself time and again on this front. Slowdowns are the best time to accelerate your communication. And there is enough evidence to show that when you accelerate your communication in a slowdown, not only do you retain your consumers, your target audience, but you actually grow on them and you gain share. And not only in the slowdown, that positive effect and impact stays on for the next couple of years at least. So I'm not getting into examples here, but all these are real business examples. So, when we communicate, who is it that we tend to communicate with? You know, somebody from here might say, well, I'm in the ethical business, I don't want to be talking about myself to the student. Well, communication is not only to your consumers. Communication is to all your stakeholders. Somebody talked about investors. Yes, it is. It is communication to your existing and potential investors. Somebody talked about talent. Yes, there might be a scarcity of talent, but still, it's the brands who tend to attract the best talent. So, when you communicate with your consumers, you do help to create demand and impact your top line, but when you communicate with the rest of your stakeholders also, you tend to impact your bottom lines. So we talked about pricing premium, we talked about talent, we talked about building, expanding business and building enterprise value. So how do we build enterprise value when we build a brand? You see, branding contributes to profitability. Why is it that when you buy a branded shirt, you tend to pay 4 times the price when the fabric and the stitching might almost be the same? You pay 3 times the price when you buy a similar shirt of a different brand from the same house. And that's the premium that you get when you build a brand. So what it does is, it helps you build image for the product, the service, and the reputation of the company, which leads to perceived quality. And I'm not saying only build perceived quality. Yes, you definitely need to back it up with actual quality, which determines customer value, which leads to better market share, better pricing, and therefore profitability. Brand image, that was branding. So brand leads to profitability and brand image leads to enterprise value. Because familiarity and favorability. I met a couple of people here over lunch. And I was completely surprised. In fact, I told them, pardon my ignorance, not come across this name. Now, familiarity and favorability tends to impact business results. And that is how you find better valuations, you find better stock prices and better market caps and better enterprise values. There is enough research to show that image contributes 5% directly to stock price and indirectly 70% to factors that explain stock price. There is a study done on 220 companies. 18%, that is one in every five companies, felt that it was the corporate brand image which directly impacted stock price. And advertising and branding is 30% of corporate brand image. So there's a Coke bottle. You take out the brand of Coke, the market cap would reduce to half. And this is not the only example. Look at any of them. Just take the brand away, and there is an erosion in their market cap. So over 4 years, S&P 500 gave a negative return of 11.5%. Corresponding period, top 100 brands portfolio gave a 30% higher return on that benchmark. You see, education is all about building intangible value. But if you need to bring in tangibility, then building a brand will help you bring in that tangible evidence of quality. And which is what will lead to the three M's. Building share of voice leads to mind share. So you have larger mind share, which leads to larger market share and eventually margins. And that is what all investors are interested in. And so are the promoters. This is what Wall Street has to say. In fact, just think of it on your balance sheet. Over a period of time, all your assets, maybe to some extent just leave real estate, but all other assets will depreciate. It is perhaps only the brand value which will appreciate over a period of time. So more than brick and mortar, what companies in the US do is first try and build brands. I recently saw this article in one of the magazines, and this is by Tim Catkins, a professor at Kellogg's. In this article, I'm not going to take you through the article, but in this article, he debates about this particular concept, whether brand building helps to build enterprise value. So I'm just going to share with you the key takeaways from this article. First, he says, building a strong brand today is incredibly difficult. Yes, it is. Second, he says that yes, brands or brand value helps build enterprise value. But he goes on further to say, not in the short run. It happens in the long run. And we as investors tend to understand this. We were talking about this in the morning. Why is this relevant to education? It's relevant to education because every time we talk of education, we say it's a high gestation business. Brand building is also an activity which takes time to reap results. And if you marry the two, it works very well. Just that you have to start in time. So if this is the thing, there is definitely a catch there too. And you have a catch, especially for Catch 22, for growing businesses. We meet clients, we meet companies, and companies say, well, you know, I need to add scale, I need to add capacity, I need to, expand my business. So where is it that I can start investing in advertising and brand building? Media costs are prohibitive. As a result of which, there is a chicken and egg. I was speaking to a gentleman this morning. He's an iBanker. He got us a client, he introduced a client to us about 3 months back. And today, the client is virtually out of business. Because he's into a business where he needed to get immediate traction from the market. He wanted to work on personal capital and not external capital. Today, the situation is that he's not being able to look for another contract. So that is where brand capital, what we represent, comes in. Over the last 7 years, we've invested more than $1 billion in about 400 companies across sectors, across regions. We help fund the long-term incremental advertising needs of growth-oriented enterprises over a long-term period of, let's say, 5 to 7 years. And if you feel the need, we could help you build the brand, or we could help you take care of your brand so that your brand takes care of you. Thank you. Questions?
In the education sector, basically we are dealing the way branding of education, because I think most of us, most of your people are thinking that education is like an industry. You know, there is a raw material, a student getting inside, and there will be a product which will come outside. In normal industry, if a raw material is going inside, the product, nobody, no stakeholder interferes with that product. He only sees the end result. But as a student, he is going inside, there are many people who interfere in the processes. It could be a parent, it could be a teacher, and during that process when you're building up your branding. So there's lots which goes in education, not, you can't relate it like an industry. Basically, you have an Apple, fine, it's a product, but we didn't interfere in the processing of the Apple phone. We are just the end users of it.
No, that's absolutely fine.
The so how point as that, when you have so many processes interfering, as a parent body, as a PTA body who interferes with it, there's a father who will be also interfering and interacting with the child, and also the teacher. The teacher has a certain view. The mother comes with a certain aspect. So branding is there also. You're taking care as a school or as a society. We don't see that happening where schools are concerned. Still, the traditional way of working is that, okay, Dune is good, MIT is good, and everybody runs towards it. Whereas a lot of process goes in making a school, which every, even the security person plays an important role in handling the security of the child. So there are many factors which, that's why I said, how can you relate a school to an Apple phone or something or the other? How do you do that branding?
Across? Okay. Can you please identify yourself?
I'm Gunita Malhotra. I run 5 schools. We run across economic backgrounds. And we are running traditional, we are not running traditional schools. We are running experiential running schools. We are running IB education schools where we give it for at one sector we are charging 45,000, and another sector we are charging 750, and giving the same infrastructure as well as we are giving the same education and international education. Mind you, we are not giving traditional CBSE education and all.
Excellent. You see, now you have a very good question there. The only limited point is, you said the student is the product. The student is not your product. The student is your consumer. Your product is the education that you're providing him. Now, if you start looking at your consumer, right, then you will have a communication targeted to him or to his parents, whoever are the decision makers, number one. Number two is, when you talk of what to communicate, in the education space, your alumni, right, what is it that you've been able to provide to the student, and how has he been able to use it and outshine the others, is a lot about communication.
Bring an awareness about, if a result A, if a student has got a result A, it is at the cost of a result B. Somebody didn't perform well, therefore you perform well. I mean, that's so you, I would not relate. I would like each and every child to be in A plus grading, sure. And marks. So if you're saying that was a reason that, oh, I had 90% A people coming out of it, so I feel that using school as an industry, I think there the mindset has to change. The school is not a factory. And that's where you cannot model, because there is a lot of things. The dignity of the child is also important. The dignity of the human being. I mean, he's not allowed to enter the classroom. Okay, may I come in the classroom for the consumer who is your main person, who's serving you. For me, my consumer is my student. And I would like to stand up when he enters me than expect him to stand when I enter the classroom.
Well, that's absolutely fine.
Yeah,
I mean,
so
you see, the limited point, the point that you made of, you know, you don't want to talk of student A at the cost of student B, which is absolutely fine. You're not denigrating any of the students, it's a question of building a communication strategy. That there are experts who can help you do that without denigrating a student B for a student A. That's the limited point.
I'm afraid we'll have to make that the final question because in the interest of time.
My name is Sandeep. You know, I just want to understand, like, brand capital helps you in building your brand. Okay, so you know, because this is from the Times of India house, do you help only through Times of India verticals, or you help through other verticals also?
Well, as of now, yes, we do it with the country's largest media house, which is the Times Group, the only media house which is present across the country. I don't want to sound like a commercial break, but the only media house which is across the country and across all media platforms. So as of now, it is through those. Going forward, let's see. We might be able to expand the offering to you.
Is it not restricting?
No, not at all. It's not restricting. It is not. It's not exclusive. So you're free to use other media as well. It's just that the capital that we bring in is used across Times Media. Right.
Thank you, Mr. Dadu.